Do not forgive your brother from your heart. That was God's word today. So as I was reading that, I had some conviction in myself. And I started realizing that there are people in my life that I have not forgiven yet. And so I ask you guys that, as you read that and as Pastor Pete comes up and the worship team comes up, who are those people that are telling you, please, have mercy on me. Please, have patience on me. As I was reading, God kept putting names after names after names, reminding me, these are the people you have to forgive. So let's pray. God, the math of forgiveness is very simple. It's to forgive as we have forgiven us. And so Lord, I ask that your faithful love would continue, because your word says that your mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. And so Lord, as we dwell in the riches of your love, Father, I ask that we allow, that we'll be able to forgive other people, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you will stir up those names in our hearts, God. That as we walk away, we will go to that person and forgive them. In your name we pray. Amen.
You and I met at Stillwater Prison. I wanted to know if you were in the same mindset of what I remember from court, where I wanted to go over and hurt you, but you were not that 16-year-old who was a grown man. I shared with you about my son.
And he became human to me. You know, when I met you, it was like, okay, this guy is real. And then when it was time to go, you broke down and started shedding tears, and the initial thing to do was just try to hold you up as best I can, just hug you like I would my own mother, you know.
After you left the room, I began to say, I just hugged the man that murdered my son, and I instantly knew that all that anger and the animosity, all the stuff I had in my heart for 12 years for you, I knew it was over, that I had totally forgiven you.
As far as receiving forgiveness from you, sometimes I still don't know how to take it, because I haven't totally forgiven myself yet. It's something that I'm learning from you. I won't say that I have learned yet, because it's still a process that I'm going through.
I treat you as I would treat my son. Our relationship is beyond belief. We live next door to one another.
Yeah, so you can see what I'm doing. You know, firsthand. We actually bump into each other all the time, weaving in and out of the house. And, you know, our conversation may come from, boy, how come you ain't called over here to check on me in a couple of days? You ain't even asked me if I need my garbage to go out. I find those things funny, because it's a relationship with a mother for real.
My natural son is no longer here. I didn't see him graduate. Now you're going to college. I'll have the opportunity to see you graduate. I didn't see him get married. Hopefully one day I'll be able to experience that with you.
But just to hear you say those things and to be in my life in the manner in which you are is my motivation. It motivates me to make sure that I stay on the right path. You still believe in me. And the fact that you can do it despite how much pain I cause you, it's amazing.
I know it's not an easy thing, you know, to be able to share our story together, even with us sitting here looking at each other right now. I know it's not an easy thing. So I admire that you can do this.
I love you, lady.
I love you too, son.
When we think about forgiveness and the math of forgiveness here in the text, Peter asks Jesus, how many times should I forgive my brother? And Jesus said, and he said, seven times? And Jesus says, no, 77 times, or 70 times seven, depending on what translation you read, which is to say that forgiveness is a continual act, a continual process. When we think about forgiveness, in that word forgiveness is the word give. Forgiveness or giving. Giving is hard enough. Giving is hard because we can manipulate the recipient into acting in a way that pleases us, because we have something that we have that the recipient is going to receive. So we can manipulate the recipient into acting in a certain way because we're going to give them a gift that they don't have. And forgiving is even harder because in forgiving, our own self-love often stands in the way. What makes forgiving doubly hard is because we create the obstacles by the actual deeds that we need to actually forgive. When we're receiving gifts, we stand empty-handed, ready to receive the good graces of the giver, the one who's giving us something. On the other hand, when we are the ones that need to forgive, our hands are burdened with pain and affliction to our bodies, to our very souls, when often we are bloody by the very person or the people that we need to forgive. So in forgiving, we don't come empty-handed. We come with a burden in our hands. There's a song by Paul Simon, and in the song he has some lyrics that says, "My religion asks me to pray for the murderer's soul, but I think you would have to be Jesus on the cross to open your heart after such a loss. Can I forgive him? Can I forgive him? No, I cannot. Can I forgive him? No, I cannot," says the song. Forgiveness can never remove the moral guilt. Human hands cannot lift the burden of guilt or scrub away the stain that it leaves. But if guilt remains, true forgiveness has not happened. I want you to think about that for a moment. God alone is the only one who can truly forgive. The Bible says that all have died in Christ, and because of that, all the wrongdoing has been separated from the wrongdoer as well as the guilt. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 through 6, talks about how we are in God's grace because we have died with Christ. We've been buried with him. We have been resurrected with him. And now we're seated at the right hand of the Father, which means that all of the pain and the guilt and the wrongdoing that we have done and experienced has died with Christ and has been resurrected anew, and is now we're sitting at the right hand of the Father. So really, the wrongdoing that we have experienced has already been settled. Which is why we alone in our own flesh cannot forgive. We have the power to do it, we have the right to do it, but not in and of ourselves, because it is truly only God who has the power and the right to forgive. That's why Jesus will have the argument with the Pharisees when he says, "I forgive you of your sins," and then the Pharisees will say, "How can you forgive sins? Only God alone can forgive sins." So we have the power to forgive, but not in our own right. We have the power to forgive by making God's forgiveness our own. See, when we tell someone, "I forgive you," we are ultimately saying, because God has already forgiven you, I no longer hold the offense against you, because God has removed the guilt and I don't count it against you either. Now that's all fine and well, but in reality, we still carry that. So what if the person who is the offender doesn't repent? You you forgive someone for what they are doing, or you want to forgive them, but they have yet to repent or to say that I'm sorry or repent before the people. Well, we have to understand that there are two laws at work here. There's a moral law, and then there's a personal law. The moral law is the universal set of rules that are underwritten by the command and the character of God. The moral law has to do with God's command and God's character. Well, the personal law has to do with our own personal hang-ups about things. So, for example, I remember when we bought our house in Carson and we had new carpet in our house. Well, we had a law or a rule that when you came over to our house, you had to take your shoes off, and we had a big bucket of brand new socks, and you had to put the socks on in order to walk on our carpet. That was our personal. If you broke that, you would not be breaking a moral code. It's just a personal code. But let's say in a relationship, a husband abuses his wife. That's not a personal law that he's breaking. That's a moral law. The moral law, if she were to be abused or he were to abuse her, and she were to declare, you know what, I forgive you, declaring, she would be declaring something that she has no authority over. I'm going to say that again. She can ask for forgiveness, or she can say that I forgive you to her abuser, but in reality, she does not have the moral authority to forgive that sin. Only God has that authority to wipe that guilt away.
Wow.
Amen. Because she can say I forgive you, but he can still feel guilty about it. And it's only going to be by the power of God to step in and to remove that guilt and that stain. God is the key. Just as he has the power to forgive and the right to forgive, we have the authority to lift the burden and to wipe the guilt away. But in reality, it's God who is doing the work through us. So when we think about forgiveness, the reason why it's hard for us to forgive and to walk in the freedom of forgiveness or to receive forgiveness and to have the guilt removed is because there are many roadblocks that stop us from doing it. There are many roadblocks. Number one, one of the roadblocks of forgiveness is what we call inner resistance. There's an inner resistance which is rooted in our own sense of justice. And this radical sense of justice is hard to remove from ourselves because of our own self-love and of our own protection. And the thought that I would say, you know what, you have offended me, but I grieve more for you, my enemy, than I do for the loss that I've suffered is some kind of otherworldly, unreachable, and it's a bit foolish. It's like it's rooted in us. The sense of justice is rooted in us. And you don't even have to teach it. It's just a part of us. When you were a kid or if you have kids, kids want a sense of justice. And you see it all the time. It's a tit for tat reaction because we want equity. We want things to be fair. We want things to be balance. And so as kids say, kids want a sense of justice. As an example, if you have more than one child and you were to give your child a scoop of ice cream, the other one will want a scoop of ice cream just like the other child, but not just another scoop, but they want the same size ice cream that you gave the other kid because they want things to be fair and balanced. As human beings, we are wired that way, and it's not bad because it guards us. It guards a keen sense of dignity that we have when it comes to a hostile world. But we have to understand that is a roadblock to forgiveness because now we're saying the scales won't be balanced in forgiveness because somebody's going to suffer loss.
Right.
But it's the inner Christ in us that allows us to forgive the way he did. Not gaining anything, but suffering through it. Suffering loss in our own forgiveness and trusting that Jesus is the one who is making amends in this world. Galatians 2:20 says, it is not I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. And the only way that I can overcome the obstacle of forgiveness with inner resistance is to understand that it is not I who lives, but that it's actually Christ that lives in me. We are in a way that we cannot, we are in God in a way that we cannot be in anybody else. And really for a moment, the only time that we are in someone or in somebody else is like when a mother has a child and a child is living inside her. But other than that, our human relationships are not within one another. They're actually beside one another. So it is only in Christ that God lives inside of us, like a baby who lives inside his or her mother's womb. Our forgiveness is but an echo of what God has already done. I'm gonna say that again because you missed it. Our forgiveness is just an echo of what God has already, you know what an echo is, somebody has already said something and you're just hearing the reverberations of it. Is that the word?
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter whether or not you did it, it's already been done. So when we say I forgive you, understand that that's just an echo of what God has already done over 2,000 years ago. So number one, the obstacle to forgiveness, one of the obstacles is our inner resistance. And number two, we must understand that forgiven people forgive others. Forgiven people forgive others. When you have accepted forgiveness, it's always easier to forgive somebody else. Mm-hmm. Christ not only came to give us gifts to the needy, but he's also given us righteousness to a condemned world. If on the bottom line of our lives, the principle that we should get, what we think is that we should get what we deserve, whether good or ill, but forgiveness will, if we think like that, forgiveness will sit uncomfortably with us. When we think that everybody should get what they deserve, forgiveness will not sit right with us. To forgive is to actually give people more than they're due. It's to release them from the debt that they have incurred, and that's bound to mess up the books when you're trying to balance it out. When you're trying to do the math of forgiveness, it's going to mess up your books. It's not going to compute. There's a movie that many people talk about when they talk about forgiveness. If you've never seen it, Les Miserables, where I can pronounce it. Miserables, yeah. I'm miserably destroying it. But this is a story, an example of grace and mercy. And if you can find it, watch it, or just watch that the one little segment that talks about the man who would steal from another man, and then he would get caught, and then the police would bring him back to the house, and he would say, "When you found the guy that took your stuff and your possessions, and here we're returning it." And the man says, "Oh no, he didn't take it. Oh, you forgot to take this too. Take that with you." And he thought he was going to condemn him, but he didn't. He let him go. Instead of joyfully receiving the gift of forgiveness, we try to pay it back because we don't like being in debt. Mm-hmm. Because we're so used to being a people who have to earn God's grace. And we can't just receive God's grace and mercy. We got to earn it, meaning that I got to make sure I show up to this and this and that, and I got to make sure I pray this way and read this and this and this, because if I don't do it, then God's not going to accept me. So I got to earn God's grace and mercy. So when I have a mindset like that, then I got to earn forgiveness. We get ruffled by grace. We sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, or saved by grace, or if not for your grace. But we really don't believe it, because we get ruffled by grace and ultimately become untransformed by grace.
Come on.
The impotence of givers and forgivers is that we can only knock at the door, and we must knock and knock and wait until the Spirit of the resurrected Christ makes the seed of forgiveness bear fruit in our lives. The third and most common obstacle to forgiveness is believing that people don't deserve it. It can be an obstacle to forgiveness for many reasons. One is the inability to do it because you may have been abused. And I don't know who it is that I'm preaching to this morning, but I'm preaching to somebody right now, and you may have been abused so much that you have gotten used to it, and the physical and the pain, the physical pain and the hurt, it runs much deeper than what bandages can even fix. It's the hurt and the pain and the damage that's done to your soul that only a God who has the power to release and restore that can make you whole again. I read a story this week of a Muslim woman who was beaten in this war-torn country. She was beaten and they urinated in her mouth. And whose name, and so when she had a kid, she named her son Jihad. And it was a reminder of the hate and the anger that developed in her soul. And she would hold her child, and while she held her child would be nursing her, she would be nursing her baby, and she would pray that her breast milk would choke her child if he ever forgot what it meant to have revenge from his mother's oppressors. Based on what happened to her, there's no way that you would think that she could ever offer any kind of forgiveness. Yes, we have the power to forgive, and yes, we have the right to forgive because Christ forgave us and forgives through us. But when you have been wounded deeply, your first need is not forgiveness from Christ, but for Him to come and give, to come to us and cradle our souls. See, before Christ can come and forgive through us, before the Spirit can even forgive us, He needs to come to dwell inside of our mortal bodies and cradle us in our souls. In other words, before you can be healed, you've got to be filled. You've got to be filled with His Spirit, an overflow of His Spirit in order to walk in forgiveness. This is the reality that Paul talks about when he's discussing the indwelling of the Holy Spirit of the church at Corinth. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 to 17, he says, "Don't you know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you?" We are the temple of God. And the Holy Spirit comes to dwell inside of us. And if the Spirit has come to dwell inside our mortal bodies, then it means that God cares about how we treat our bodies and how others treat our bodies. Bodies are sacred spaces where the indistinguishable Spirit of God dwells. So even as broken as we are and as fragile as we are, God still us. It's because of God's Spirit that's in us that we all, human beings, have a trace of forgiveness in us. It's why it's so interesting we as Christians don't have a corner on the market when it comes to forgiveness. I know we think we do, but Christianity does not have a corner in the market on forgiveness. Most people of faith, even atheists or agnostics, have the ability to walk in forgiveness. It's because we're all made in the image of God. We are all God-bearing people. So even in the story of the Muslim woman, there was still some evidence of a seed of forgiveness in her. If you read that whole story about her life, she states there she wanted revenge because she thought it was the only way, which means that she knew that there was another way. The second piece of evidence in that story, of this Muslim woman, she was a teacher. And she said, you know, it was a seed of forgiveness in her by the fact that she always reiterated that she was a teacher of love. So even in a Muslim woman, there is still a seed of forgiveness that comes from the Spirit of God. So even when we feel like we cannot forgive or we shouldn't forgive, there is still the seed of forgiveness that's buried in each and every one of us, and we're waiting for the Spirit of God to make it come and bear fruit in our lives. Amen. So the question then is, well, don't perpetrators, offenders, don't they have the responsibility to mend the fence too? Why is it just one side? Isn't there another side to this? And I would say, yes, they do. We suspect that the offender will repeat the offense when they're not willing to repent. When a person is not willing to say that I'm sorry, when a person is not willing to repent, there's this blockage, that this obstacle that comes because we feel like if they don't repent, then they're going to have the propensity to repeat the offense or do it again. So what happens is that we withhold our own forgiveness as a way to protect ourselves. And we're also reluctant to forgive when we think that the offender feels as if they haven't done anything wrong. So what we end up doing is rubbing their noses in the wrongdoing rather than just releasing them from the guilt and the punishment. But when we choose to forgive, we are assigning blame and condemning the offender. But the difference is that with forgiveness is that we are doing it gently and lovingly. So here's a question that I asked God on this week. As I thought about forgiveness and I thought about like the African-American community and black and brown communities, or when we think about like all of the things that have happened historically with systemic injustice and slavery and just mass incarceration, just all of these different things that have come about throughout the years and the centuries, I asked God, why must the oppressed always bear the burden of forgiveness? Why is it that we always gotta say, I forgive you? You've done my community wrong. Okay, I forgive you. And they still haven't repented. The system still doesn't repent. And we still say, okay, I forgive you. And what God said to me is that the reason why the oppressed must carry a burden is because it's the result of being a follower of Christ. Mm-hmm. When we offer forgiveness, we get restored to our full human capacity because we mirror God in His ways.
Amen.
Thank you. Offering forgiveness as someone who is in a position of being oppressed, it's not that you want to, it's that God is commanding us to. And the reason why He commands us to is because He did it. And if He does it and we do it, then we are being restored to our full humanity of being image bearers of God in this earth. happens when the perpetrator pursues forgiveness but can't receive it because the oppressed is dead, or the oppressor is dead, or incapacitated, or is no longer around. In other words, what if I want to forgive someone and they cannot receive my forgiveness because they passed away, or because they moved away, or because there is no more communication with that person, or they just have the inability to do it? Even in my own life, when I thought about my own father and offering forgiveness to him, and I was struggling with it when I realized that he did not have the capacity to receive it because of his addiction. So what do you do with that? What do you do when someone does not have the capacity to receive it because they died, or they're addicted, or because they're incapacitated, or they just cannot do it? And I say to you, remember that when the perpetrator pursues forgiveness but can't receive it, it's because the oppressed is dead or incapacitated. Remember that God is the only one truly who has the right and the power to forgive. So the oppressor who can't get it from the victim can only receive it from God. If the oppressed is not able to forgive the oppressor or lives with that wound of unforgiveness in their lives, we may believe to whatever extent that the offender or the offense has forgiven rightly or wrongly, but our job is to forgive and to offer it and trust that God will do it completely. It's not on us. The burden is on God. One of the things about forgiveness is that we never know enough about the victim, the perpetrator, or the offense. I'm going to say that again. One of the things about wanting forgiveness or seeking forgiveness or trying to receive forgiveness is that all of it is only partial. It's like when the Bible says you look dimly into a glass because you don't know the full story about the victim or the oppressor or even the actual act that caused this whole situation to happen. You would have to be God or omniscient to know all those kinds of facts. That's why we approach it with humility and be willing to admit that we may have gotten the wrongdoing wrong. All right. Mm-hmm. Because we don't know everything about it. And that we may need to even revise our own judgments about situations.
Amen.
There was a quote I read this week that says, since as forgivers, we don't know enough about the offense or the offenders, we should ask them and learn from them about it. True, they too may not understand either themselves or their offense sufficiently, and yet they can shed at least some light on their motives, their feelings, their struggles, their deeds, and failures, and in the process, make us better forgivers. Forgivers need offenders help to forgive well. Once again, forgiveness is not a solitary individual act. The last obstacle that I shared with you this morning when it comes to forgiveness is groupthink. Somebody say groupthink. Groupthink and social structures of our communities force us to behave in certain ways. Even when we pride ourselves on being independent, for thinking on our own heads and choosing with our own unconstrained wills, that we in fact think and choose often merely is echoes the choices of a group to which we belong and a wider culture in which we live. So when we think that we're offering forgiveness or not offering forgiveness, that we're doing it on an individual basis, it's really not true. We are being influenced by whatever community or group that we have associated ourselves with. We are shaped by our community. We're shaped by the community that we live in. We're shaped by the communities that we worship in. We're shaped by the communities that we fellowship in. there was a young lady in Yugoslavia whose 5-year-old son was killed by the army, and she forgave him. And it was because for 2 decades, she was part of a church community that practiced Christ. She was prepared for that moment with the joys and pains of being in that community. For 2 decades, God was preparing her for that moment. Because she belonged to a community that prayed in that community, that listened to preaching about love of enemies, that celebrated Christ's death for the ungodly and partook in the Lord's Supper together. They sang together about God's faithfulness and love, and they entrusted children to God's care and dedicated them to God's service, and they celebrated baptisms of those whose sins had been washed in the blood of the Lamb, and they mourned the dead in the hope of resurrection, and they forgave because they were part of a community that followed Christ, for whom Scripture wasn't a religious book, but was a life-shaping word of the living God. This Yugoslavian woman who was part of this church community for 20 years, 2 decades, God was shaping her in that community, molding her in that community, because he knew it was going to be for such a time as that. So their whole life of faith in that community, best practice flowed into that single decision and made a difficult act of forgiveness for her possible. Some of us have been in church for years, and God has been shaping you in the community you've been a part of. He's been shaping you for such a time as this. He's been shaping you for a moment when some cataclysmic event in your life will take place, and God has prepared you for a time such as this. Every hug that you've shared in church, every song of worship that you sang, every message that you've heard, and every amen that you've said, God has been preparing you for a moment of forgiveness for a time such as this.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
In his grace and mercy. So how does the God who forgives work in the lives of forgivers? Not through the isolated decision of self-enclosed individuals, but through a life lived in response to God's grace and through a community that makes the practice of forgiveness meaningful. So do you want to become a forgiving person? If you want to become a forgiving person, then I encourage you to seek the company of forgiven people. Amen?
We end tonight with one of the most potent powers on earth. It can change lives in an instant. Everyone has it. It's the power to forgive. Watch it now in action in Steve Hartman's Assignment America.
Thank you, Lord.
In a small apartment building in North Minneapolis, a 59-year-old teacher's aide sings praise to God for no seemingly apparent reason. Indeed, if anyone was to have issues with the Lord, it would be Mary Johnson.
For all you've done for me.
He never had a chance.
In February 1993, Mary's son, Loramian Bird, was shot to death during an argument at a party. He was 20, and Mary's only child.
My son was gone.
The killer was a 16-year-old kid named O'Shea Israel.
I wanted justice. He was an animal. He deserved to be caged.
And he was. Tried as an adult and sentenced to 25 and a half years, O'Shea served 17 before being recently released. He now lives back in the old neighborhood, close to Mary. This close.
He lives next door.
Next door.
How a convicted murderer ended up living a door jam away from his victim's mother is a story not of horrible misfortune, as you might expect, but of remarkable mercy.
A few years ago, Mary asked if she could meet O'Shea here at Minnesota's Stillwater State Prison. As a devout Christian, she felt compelled to see if there was some way, if somehow, she could forgive her son's killer.
What'd she say to you?
I believe the first thing she said was, look, you don't know me, I don't know you, let's just start with right now. And I was befuddled myself.
O'Shea says they met regularly after that. When he got out, she introduced him to her landlord, who, with Mary's blessing, invited O'Shea to move into the building. Today, they don't just live close, they are close. Clearly, Mary was able to forgive.
Unforgiveness is like cancer. It will eat you from the inside out. It's not about that other person. Me forgiving him does not diminish what he's done. Yes, he murdered my son, but the forgiveness is for me. It's for me.
For O'Shea, it hasn't been that easy.
I haven't totally forgiven myself yet. I'm learning how to forgive myself, and I'm still growing towards, you know, trying to forgive myself and what it is I've done.
To that end, O'Shea is now busy proving himself to himself. He works at a recycling plant by day and goes to college by night. He says he's determined to pay back Mary's clemency by contributing to society. In fact, he's already working on it, singing the praises of God and forgiveness at prisons, churches, to large audiences everywhere.
Forgiveness is a powerful thing.
Yes, I'm grateful.
Which explains why Mary can sing yes, her praise of thanks to her audience so of one. Steve Hartman, CBS News, Minneapolis.
For all you've done for me.